Well, good evening, everyone, and let's call to order our Lynnwood City Council business meeting for this evening, Monday, December 10th, 2018. And if we could start with our flag salute led by President Goodwin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And the roll call, please.
Okay.
Mayor Smith?
Here.
Council President Goodwin?
Present.
Council Vice President Sessions?
Here.
Councilmember Ross?
Here.
Councilmember Cotton?
Happy to be here.
Councilmember Sutton?
Here.
Councilmember Hurst?
Here.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Here.
Council's President, Mayor.
Thank you. Moving on to item 30, the approval of our minutes. Council Vice President Sessions, please.
Yes,
please. Thank you.
Yes, that is me. Okay, approval of the minutes. I'd like to move approval of the minutes for the Finance Committee meeting November 15th, the work session on November 21st, and the work session on December 3rd.
Second.
Any amendments, corrections? No? All those in favor of approving the minutes as read, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Thank you. Messages from the mayor. I have a couple of things to relate tonight. I first want to speak a little bit about the hate crime incident that happened outside of our city boundaries in unincorporated Lynnwood. The detectives with the Snohomish County Sheriff's Major Crimes Unit are working with the FBI following the arrest of 8 males who were self-professed members of the neo-Nazi skinhead group and were arrested after allegedly assaulting 2 black males at a bar just outside of Lynnwood on Saturday night. I think now, though, we think that it's 1 black male and 1 Asian male. Although this happened in unincorporated Lynnwood, this is very close to home. And we want to take this opportunity to remind our community members that the City of Lynnwood, including myself, the Council, and the Police Department, are committed to being a safe and welcoming community for all. And we condemn the acts of hate that occurred over the weekend. And it's not just us elected and the police that are committed to keeping Lynnwood safe. All departments contribute to the safety and well-being of our community by keeping our roads and parks, finances, data, everything safe. The men who were arrested were booked for several charges, including harassment, malicious harassment, which under the Washington state law is a hate crime, and fourth degree assault. Our Lynnwood police officers provided mutual aid that evening and helped apprehend some of the suspects. The Lynnwood Police Department will remain vigilant to keep our city safe for all that choose to live here peacefully. Kudos to the Snohomish County Sheriff's Office for their quick actions to hold these perpetrators of hate responsible for their actions. And I just want to share a few bits of recap for the end of our year here. And I wanted to take the opportunity to thank our City Council for their great leadership over this past year. I think together we've garnered several accomplishments that are laying a great foundation to build Lynnwood's future. We don't always agree 100%, but that's okay. And I honestly can say that we're all working with Lynnwood's best interest in mind. Council, this year you've supported major infrastructure improvements to help maintain our single most expensive asset. That would be our city streets. You've adopted numerous ordinances that refreshed outdated, sometimes archaic codes. You've passed legislation to support our community's most vulnerable with amendments to the tent encampment and extreme weather codes. You've adopted codes that help to simplify our business licensing. You've recognized and celebrated lots of deserving individuals and groups and causes. Through our lobbying and legislative engagement efforts, we've confirmed the $1.2 billion in federal funding for Sound Transit's Lynnwood Link extension, and we've secured millions in grants for localized projects. And most recently, you passed the 2019-2020 biennial budget that will help guide us into the future. It's been a really busy year, and I hope that you all have a very relaxing and rejuvenating time off during this holiday, because come January, we're going to hit the ground running. And if you thought 2018 was busy, hold on, So I just wanted to wish all of you and our Lynnwood community a great holiday and a great new year. So at this time, we're moving on to our citizen comments. As always, I'll start with those who've signed up on the list. I'll call you forward. Please state your name and address, and you'll have 3 minutes to address council. The person on the list is Ted Heichel.
First, Merry Christmas to the council and to the mayor. Ted Heichel, 3820, 191st Place Southwest in Lynnwood. One curious question I had was, there are no approval of minutes. I had no minutes from November 28th meeting. You had the December 3rd meeting, but there's a skip in the November 28th. That came to my attention. I do want to comment on an item on your agenda later on, the Ordinance for Neighborhood Permit Parking Program. I support that kind of a program because we live in neighborhoods where we've seen that impact of people who live in apartments and they don't have enough space in the apartments to park. It ends up in single-family neighborhoods. Also, I might mention there's a law office just across from the library right next to the police station, and very often the people who work there park on 192nd Street, so they leave their parking for clients to come in, but there's a problem with overflow parking. You know, from your agenda tonight, it says, quote, not long after the Shag Senior Housing Building opened on 40th Avenue West, because of the availability of transit along 196th Street Southwest, and because the residents are elderly and very low parking ratio was allowed for this building, I believe it was 0.9 per unit, it's become apparent that many more current residents wish to keep a vehicle than there are parking spaces available within the parking garage. This has led to a spillover parking on 40th Avenue West, 194th, and 192nd. I would hope that in the first part of next year, maybe January, you take a look at what you allow for multifamily housing parking and also address the question of whether the new apartments that are being built, whether they are going to require people to pay extra for parking, because that again drives people out of the building and into our neighborhoods. What I really came here tonight for, I was telling my wife I wanted to talk about the cold weather shelter. She reminded me, oh yeah, when you were on the council, you remember you used to go down and open the front door at night on times when staff wasn't around to let the people come inside and be warm until the bus came to pick them up. And of course, for 2 years, we had the cold weather shelter right here in this room because it was sprinkled. I had a little to do with the cold weather shelter, but I'll tell you a person who really did have a lot to do with the cold weather shelter. Her name was Anita Bate. I don't know whether any of you ever met Anita, but she was rambunctious, direct, very, very much on the issue that she cared about. And she cared about the cold weather shelter. And she worked the cold weather shelter night after night. She was a wonderful woman, a wife, a mother, a grandmother. She was a retired Navy wife. Her husband had been in the Navy many years. And she put in what we're all supposed to do when you're asked, have you done it for the least? Have you offered your time and your effort to service the least in our world? That's a question religiously we're often asked if we profess the Christian faith. Anita did that, and she did a lot more. And I'm sorry if you didn't get to meet her a little over a week ago. She had an aneurysm, and last Wednesday she died. And if you go and talk with any of the people who work with the cold weather shelter, mention Anita's name, and they'll tell you what a wonderful person this was. Her funeral was this morning at St. Thomas More Church. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others who would like to speak tonight? Yes, sir. And might I add, if you're here to speak about the public hearing, then hold your comments till then. But if it's something else, please.
Oh, I was just going to comment also on the ordinance. For
thank you.
Parking.
Yeah. So your name and address?
My name is Brent Colvin. My address is 20929 45th Place West in Lynnwood.
Thank you.
I just wanted to, I'm not going to take a full 3 minutes. I just want to say thank you for getting this issue up to this point where it's a discussion. I fully support that ordinance. Living in the neighborhood off of 45th, seeing the parking kind of come into the neighborhood, and it's kind of like coming through a parking lot each night. You know, there's people walking around, except there's no safety lights and things like that. So it's a little concerning. It has been a little concerning, and I think as I first noticed it a couple months ago, my wife and I just said, well, we should probably just start looking elsewhere for a home. And so we did that. We got an agent. We started looking elsewhere. And then I heard that the council was hearing some of the concerns. And so, well, maybe there's an easier solution. Maybe we can kind of take care of some of the issues we're having there in a more easy way than having to pack up and leave. And So thank you guys for getting it to this point, and I just want to say I support it, and I hope that it moves forward. Yes?
Coleman, C-O-L-M-A-N.
Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak this evening? Yes, sir.
Hi. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
You might want to move your microphone a little. It moves. Just push it up. There you go.
My name is Pete Andrich. I live at 20900 45th Place West. Andrich, A-N-D-R-I-C-H. And I've spoke to the council before, and I hope this isn't repetitive, but I am also fully in support of the parking permit ordinance. For about the last year and a half, our street, 209th Street Southwest, has been transformed into it's basically a auto wrecking yard / Scriber Creek apartment dumpster almost. I just had to pick up 9 water bottles in my front yard. Just somebody opens their door, just throws them all out. So anyway, 3 weeks ago, I had 2 cars impounded. Both of them have been parked there for over 6 months, and the officer who came to answered the call, I believe it was Officer Preston, and my hat's off to him. He looked at the cars, and instead of tagging and towing them, he immediately had them impounded. One of them had a plate that didn't match the vehicle. I don't know if it was a stolen car or what, but like I said, it's been there six months, and probably would have been 6 years if hadn't been put to their attention. But anyway, the reason I bring that up, it's obvious that the call on one car at a time is not going to work. It's just it's a hassle for the residents and also for Lynnwood PD. It is a low priority for them. So I think it's the only viable option is to enact that parking permit ordinance and have it actually enforced. Anyway, that's all I had to say. Thanks so much for your time tonight.
Thank you. Anybody else? All right. This evening, we do not have presentations and proclamations. Are they in the packet?
I don't know that.
Are the minutes in the packet from December or November 26th? Oh, the transcriber was sick. Okay, so they'll be in the packet next time. Okay, thank you for bringing that to our attention.
And for the record, that was November 26th. Yeah.
Okay. Any written communications or petitions that I haven't got? All right, it's time for council comments. And this evening, I'd like to start with Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you very much. I think that this has been a great year. A lot of things have happened, which the mayor has already kind of went through. But I just want to say to all of you, I wish you the best of the new year. Sometimes people make resolutions, but I had a wise lady say, she makes intentions, and I think I'm going to adopt that. I like the way that sounds, because I never get through my resolutions at all. So I just wish all of you the best and in good health. Thank you.
Councilmember Frizzell?
I would agree with Councilmember Sutton. I still have my intentions from a couple years ago, but I look at them on a regular basis. They're right on my kitchen door, so, and I go, I did pretty good on that one. Well, I need to work on that one. And I agree, intentions. I wanted to talk about, I was at the menorah lighting celebration that was outside of City Hall a week ago Sunday, and as was President Goodwin, and Councilmember Hurst also was there. And it was just wonderful to gather with a celebration of a faith that I don't ascribe to, but to have the diversity there and to just be able to embrace it and just rejoice with people in their own faith. And it was outstanding. I would encourage each of us to get out of our own little box, our comfort zone, our churches, our whatever, and just be willing to get a little uncomfortable. And you never know how much you're going to be blessed just by being around other people. Celebrating what is important to them, and I enjoyed it very much. Have a Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, all the others that I don't have on the tip of my tongue.
Councilmember Hurst.
Great. Thank you. It was good to be at the menorah lighting, and then the night before was the Christmas tree lighting, and, but I think it was important. Most important to be at the menorah lighting, just to show some solidarity, considering what happened in Pittsburgh at the synagogue, and now, just recently here in unincorporated Lynnwood, that, there's still people out there that need to have a epiphany, I think, in their thinking. But to let you know, the council never sleeps. Even though we aren't meeting in December, we do still have boards and commissions that meet. And so that will go on. So don't worry about us. We'll be busy. Just a comment. So this morning I'm driving into my full-time job in Seattle, and Cairo announces out of the blue, City of Lynnwood does not turn back car tab fees or something like that. And I just thought, really? And, because it's so easy to say that, and yet we really struggled with that and had a lot of thought going into it. And it just sometimes, God bless the media, I don't understand them sometimes, And, of course, then the tag at the end was that the average car tab fee in Lynnwood is $400. And I thought, holy cow, there are people in the city that have a lot nicer cars than I do, because I don't pay that. But the point is, with those car tab fees, we went round and round. What do we do about it? And really, I think part of the decision was, of course, this is the Transportation Benefit District Board, not the council that made the decision, but we all are part of that board. I think two things. One, all the work that was done over the summer of the streets, I think people finally started to see that this money is being put to good use. And two, we do have programs that have much more impact on low-income folks as far as getting discounts on utility, which is a lot more per year than $20 or $40 break. But I thank Cairo for reminding me of all that, but, We don't make decisions like that lightly. And thank you.
Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Yes, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Happy New Year. I think that we all hold this in our heart up here and out there in our community, but just it's always good to have a reminder that during this season is a time to do what we can to extend ourselves, our resources and what we have, and extend it across to the most vulnerable in our community or those that are without. Take time. I know that, we live in, a very busy, very congested, isolated world, it seems like. There's so many ways to be disconnected. So I just encourage you during the season to connect with your fellow, with your neighbors, with your other community members, and just get to know each other. I think, unfortunately, a lot of things that the media reminds us still exist could be largely solved if we got out of our day-to-day isolated grid and put our head up and said hello to somebody new. So I encourage you all to do that. Looking forward to 2019. It's been a great year here on council and at the city, and looking forward to many more. Thank you.
Councilmember Ross.
Yes, thank you. Hope everyone has a wonderful holiday season and particularly a very happy new year. Paul got your email. It's not a good thing, but I understand. Also, just really everybody have a wonderful, we'll have a little bit of a break here as council. We'll still be busy, but we get some break from night meetings for a little bit. And everybody just have a wonderful time this holiday season. Thank you.
Vice President Sessions.
Thank you. Just thank you for everything that everybody has said, and me too. I am grateful for this opportunity to serve the community. I don't take it lightly, and a break like this is a good time to reflect and listen and be called deeper, and that's what we plan to do at my home. And I just wish you all a blessed season and new year. Thank you.
Council President.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want to wish everyone a Merry Christmas, a Happy New Year, Happy Hanukkah, and Kwanzaa. And I don't know all the holidays that are celebrated, but as Councilmember Frizzell said, it was fantastic to see and be part of a celebration, again, of a religion that I don't ascribe to, but to see a number of people there actually that I know that were not Jewish because they mentioned that they were not Jewish, but they wanted to come and celebrate that time of season, and it's a wonderful opportunity to do those things. I often up here like to, I guess I kind of say brag on my kids and some of the things that they do, and the youth of the city of Lynnwood in general. But this year, my lovely spouse decided that she was going to do something different for our Christmas season. So the day after Thanksgiving, she gave each of our kids some cash and said, this is for you to spend. The one thing that you cannot spend it on is yourself. And so she gave them from that day until Christmas to do this. But the other caveat is that they were to write down, or for a four-year-old that can't write, just remember what he did with that cash, so that when we come together on Christmas, we can share the experience they had trying to help someone else. And I say that because, similar to what Councilmember Cotton was talking about, this is a time for, and Councilmember Sessions mentioned as well, this is a time for us to reflect and not only because of the Christmas season, the holiday season, but as the year closes and we start a new year. The one wish that I would have is that we could have that same and constant caring for one another throughout the whole year. And I would urge us to do that. And I know as we, the council, discuss many of the things that we have throughout the year, a lot of that comes up. When we talk about the card tab fees, when we talk about taxes and fees and what we're going to do, the things that come up are how is this going to affect the citizens of Lynnwood? And that is because each one of us up here cares about the citizens of Lynnwood. We care what happens to the citizens because, one, we're citizens of Lynnwood, but two, we know that there are many that haven't, that don't have the same temporal blessings that we have. They don't have the same living standards. Maybe they're newer to the country. They don't understand a number of things, and that makes it more difficult for them to progress right now. So those are all things we keep in mind, and I wish and hope that we will continue to do that throughout the year and not just during this time of season. And I would urge all of us as citizens to do the same thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Council. We'll move on to item 90. 90.1 is our unanimous consent agenda, and Councilmember Hurst, looks like you have your work cut out for you.
I do. I'm hoping, would any council member like to remove any item from the consent agenda?
Oh, too bad. So sad.
Okay. So, I move to adopt the following consent agenda items. A, appointments, Tourism Advisory Committee / Lodging Tax Advisory Committee for 2019. Confirm appointments to the Tourism Advisory Committee, Lodging Tax Advisory Committee for one-year terms ending December 31st, 2019. Position number 3, Lodging Tax Collector, Georgia Borg-Leon. General Manager, Marriott Residence Inn. Position 4, Lodging Tax User, Grant Dole, Lynnwood Public Facilities District. Position 5, Lodging Tax User, Amy Spain, Snohomish County Tourism Bureau. Position 6, Restaurateur, Linda Geddes, Sparta's Pizza and Pasta. Position 7, Retail Representative, Brenda Klein, General Manager, Alderwood. Position 8, Citizen Representative, Debbie Mueller. Okay. Item B, contract, City of Lynnwood and Lynnwood Police Management Guild. Authorize the mayor to sign the contract and attendant MOU between the City of Lynnwood and the Lynnwood Police Management Guild. Item C, contract expenditure authority. Advertisement, sales, graphic design, printing of recreation guide. Authorize the mayor to expend an estimated annual amount of $120,000 for the design, advertising, sales, printing, and mailing of the recreation guide, inclusive of taxes. The contract is valid through October 31st, 2021. D, item 1, construction contract award, and item 2, contract for construction engineering services for the sewer force main number 8. 1, authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a construction contract with Tappany Incorporated of Battleground, Washington for the construction of the Sewer Force Main No. 8 Improvements Project, an amount not to exceed $2,530,765.44, with an additional 15% contingency for a total amount of $2,910,000. Sales tax is included. Item 2, authorize the mayor to enter into and execute on behalf of the city a contract with BHC Consultants for Construction Engineering Support Services of the Sewer Force Main No. 8 Improvements Project in an amount not to exceed $225,000, which includes a management reserve. Sales tax does not apply. We're getting there. Item E, number 1, design, and number 2, right-of-way consultant contract supplements, 196th Street Southwest Improvements. Item 1, authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a contract supplement with David Evans and Associates to provide additional design services in an amount not to exceed $340,000. Sales tax do not apply. Item 2, authorize the mayor to enter into and execute a contract supplement with Contract Land and Staff, CLS, to provide additional property acquisition services in the amount not to exceed $130,000. Sales tax do not apply. Item F, contract award, Lynnwood Link Light Rail Extension Consulting Services. Authorize the mayor to execute a contract with Parametrics of Seattle for 2 years with an option to extend for two additional two-year terms. The initial two-year term has an estimated value of $1 million. Item G, contract extension, Lynnwood Link Extension, LLE, Light Rail Consulting Services. Authorize the mayor to execute a contract extension for up to 12 months with BHC. The extension of the contract will not exceed the remaining estimated value of $265,000. Item H, Sound Transit Interlocal Agreement, reimbursement for LLE services. Authorize the mayor to execute an amendment to the Sound Transit Agreement, increasing the value by an estimated $2,500,000 until December 31st, 2025. Item I, Final Acceptance, Water Main Replacement Project. Grant final acceptance of the work performed under the contract for the 2017 Water Lines Replacement Project, subject to the requirements of appropriate state and federal agencies, and ultimately release of the retention to the contractor, if any. Finally, item J, voucher approval. Approve claims and payroll in the amount of $2,569,268.37 and $1,080,140.55, respectively.
Bravo. Our unanimous consent agenda will be approved as read. Council, we'll move on to 90.2. This is a public hearing this evening. So this is our agenda item, 90.2A. This is for the Shoreline Master Program Periodic Update, and not Shoreline the City. No. So at this time, the City Council and I will conduct a public hearing on the Shoreline Master Program Periodic Update. Thank you for attending and participating this evening. The purpose of the public hearing is to allow the public to express their views on matters under consideration by the City Council. Decisions will not be made until after citizens have had the opportunity to share their views. Updating the Shoreline Master Program is a legislative action, and common rules for the legislative public hearings apply. Public hearings must be fair and free of conflicts of interest. Before we start the proceedings, and this also applies to myself, does any council member have any conflict of interest regarding this matter? All right. Now the public hearing is officially open. The sequence of tonight's public hearing will be as follows. City staff will provide an oral report that summarizes the matter at hand. The City Council may ask clarifying questions specifically related to staff's presentation or the written information provided. Members of the audience will be invited to come to the lectern to share information you wish the City Council to consider. I will first call for speakers from the sign-up sheet that was located outside the chamber's entrance. And next, I will call for speakers who have not signed up. After the public testimony portion of this hearing, I will invite City staff to offer clarifying information responsive to the public comments. The City Council may ask clarifying questions of the speakers specifically related to their testimony. Citizen responses must be made from the lectern. After each citizen has had the opportunity to speak and the City Council is ready to begin its deliberation, I will close the public hearing. After the hearing's closed, the City Council can begin its deliberation and ultimately determine what action should be taken. As I indicated earlier, final decisions on the budget, on this Shoreline Master Plan will not be made until, let's just stop as the council will deliberate and then determine what action to take. As mayor, my role is to facilitate the hearing and council's deliberation. It's important that public hearings are conducted in a manner that is equitable to all. We'll use the following ground rules for this public hearing. Written minutes and an electronic recording of this meeting are being made. When coming to the lectern, speakers should state their name and address. Please speak into the microphones so that others can hear you. Comments may only be made from the lectern. Only one person may speak at a time, and speakers will be allowed up to 3 minutes to share their views. When multiple people in the audience are represented by one spokesperson, as demonstrated by a show of hands, the council will consider the testimony to be from each of those persons. If the spokesperson speaks on behalf of others, I will grant the spokesperson an additional 2 minutes to speak. I may adjust the order of speakers when doing so supports the purpose of this hearing. Everyone's asked to respect opinions that differ from yours and to help ensure members of the audience are not intimidated or discouraged from expressing their views. The purpose of this hearing is to receive citizen input. This is not the time for back and forth discussion or for debate. So this public hearing is underway, and I will now ask Ashley Winchell to provide an overview of the topic at hand. Welcome.
Good evening. So I believe this was before you all early in the fall as a work session item. So since then, we have had, we're doing a joint review with the Department of Ecology. And so we had a public hearing that was joint with the Department of Ecology about a month ago before City Plan Commission. So this is the final step to having the Shoreline Master Program adopted ahead of schedule, which is always good. So I'll go into the updates quickly. So the Shoreline Master Program is a result of the Shoreline Management Act, which was adopted in 1972. On the screen is the wastewater treatment plant, which is adjacent to the 700 feet of shoreline that's regulated by the Shoreline Master Program. So it's a very big document for a very small piece of land. But essentially, it was put together to make sure that there wasn't piecemeal management of the shorelines, that they're all being held to a minimum standard, and then we can, of course, regulate more than that minimum standard. And so that's what our Shoreline Master Program does. So just quickly again, it's tailored to the specific needs of the community. It includes both plans and regulations, so it talks about our goals for the shoreline, as well as if development were to happen on the shoreline, how would that development take place and what's permitted to happen. The first Shoreline Master Program was adopted by the City of Lynnwood in 2011. So our Shoreline Management, our Shoreline Master Program is actually due in 2019. So if we get it done in 2018, we'll be a year early on getting it done. And we've talked to the Department of Ecology. There's a lot of larger cities that are due in 2019 too. So getting it done early has been helpful for them, being able to give us extra review and things like that. So the shoreline also, it's the wastewater treatment plant's completely surrounded by Edmonds. So the City of Edmonds, of course, has their own Shoreline Master Program. So this is just a piece of one of the many Shoreline Master Programs for the Puget Sound. Here's some views of our shoreline. So the image on the left is actually looking southwest and then looking directly west in the middle, and then looking north on the right. And these were all taken with the city's drone, so it was kind of cool. We got to go out there and see what our shoreline looks like from above. We also went down and looked at the shoreline. So it's divided from the wastewater treatment plant by the railroad tracks, and it's hard to tell from these images, but on the west side of the tracks, it kind of dramatically drops. So it's a little bit difficult to actually get to the shore. You have to be somewhat brave. I wasn't brave enough to go down there, but I took pictures from the railroad tracks. The image on the left is the wastewater treatment plant, again, looking west. And then the image on the right, it's difficult to see, but there's right here some pilings from a former dock that are mentioned in the Shoreline Master Program. So again, it needs to be reviewed every 8 years. The Department of Ecology puts together a really helpful checklist of all the things that have changed in the Revised Code of Washington and the WAC, and essentially what needs to change in the Shoreline Master Program to make sure our Shoreline Master Program is up to the state's requirements. So we reviewed that checklist against our existing Shoreline Master Program, determined what changes needed to be made, and then made those changes. We've sent the draft document to Ecology, and they haven't seen any changes they believe need to be made, so we're in pretty good shape there. It's set up into several sections that have different information, and then the introduction really goes into the public engagement process. We've updated that to reflect what we did for public engagement in 2018. We did a very similar program to what we did previously, which was just mailing notices, putting up signage, having public hearings. We have not gotten any feedback from residents or anything like that. We did have some feedback from one of the tribal agencies, but nothing substantial. Section 2 just outlines the goals for our Shoreline Master Program. 3 goes into the environmental designations. Most of the shoreline in Lynnwood is high intensity, which is water-oriented commercial transportation or industrial uses because of our wastewater treatment plant. Four goes into the general policies and regulations, and there's several topics within there. And then there's also the policies and regulations for specific shoreline uses in Section 5. So if this use is permitted along the shoreline, these are the regulations that further restrict or allow that use. The reality is it's probably very unlikely we'll have any development in our shoreline that isn't related to the wastewater treatment plant. It's very difficult to get to that land. There are a variety of property owners, people who own land in Edmonds that at some point was divided by the railroad and still own pieces of land along the shoreline. But the reality of them doing something there is very slim because it's very difficult to get to that land. There's policies and regulations for shoreline modifications. So if there's some sort of erosion control or something like that, how that would need to take place. And then administrative regulations. So if anyone did come forward with a proposal, how would that proposal be reviewed and approved? There's a lot of appendices, too, that go into whether it's a definition. There's a lot of definitions because there's a lot of terms that we just don't use a lot, a lot of terms related to water management. The map portfolio, so we updated all the maps when possible. We've gotten a lot better aerial imagery since this was last updated, so all of the aerial maps were updated, and then we cleaned them up just to make them more legible and more uniform. And then there are several appendix D and E are related to information that impacted the regulations, so looking at the ecology of our shoreline, and there's also lists of restoration projects which could improve the ecological functions, but there was a timeline for those happening, but none of those have taken place, so we updated that timeline, and that's the only thing we really updated in that appendix. Lastly, just going into some of the examples of our updated maps, we just tried to improve legibility on them. Overall, that's a very quick summary of what we've done for our Shoreline Master Program. It won't need to be updated again until 2027 unless they change how often we have to update them. So this should keep us should keep us good for the next 8 years. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you, Ashley, which moves us right into, does any member of council have a question to clarify information provided during the staff presentation or in your written materials? Yeah, Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, thank you all. First of all, staff, I think you underplay your role. It's a 325 pages or so document that you've gone through, so good job for what it is. I appreciate your thoroughness on it. So for the members in the audience that are like, oh, this is just some maps, it's quite an extensive document. So it sounds like from your presentation or from the materials present, the Department of Ecology has concluded their review and they offered no comments or any comments were included?
Yeah, it's they submitted to us a statement of initial concurrence, which essentially means that they've reviewed our changes and it's in compliance with the state regulations.
Excellent. Okay, great. And then you had also mentioned that we had kind of reached out and gotten some feedback from some of the local tribes. Were those comments also included in the report?
They just wanted to be a party of record. Okay. And then they also asked if we'd had any progress on any of our restoration plans, which we have not since the original document was approved.
Okay, great. Well, I'm glad that we're being responsive to that. Those are all my questions. Great work.
Any other questions? All right, then at this time, I'd like, I need to ask, are there any new written materials or correspondence that council has not received?
No.
No? Okay. So now I'll invite members of the audience to come forward and speak, starting with those who have signed up. And Mr. Heichel, I'd like to start with you.
Thank you, Your Honor, Council. I did read the whole document, but I had read the whole document in 2011 because I was on the council voting in favor of this back then. I did want to point out a couple of things. The changes that were made were basically because of the revised code of Washington, the Washington Administrative Code requirements that have since come down. I was surprised to find out we have a city drone. I didn't realize that. But the big things, two big things that I caught that are changes, because much of what is there is the same thing we had in 2011. But the changes that I thought were very interesting were the possibility of removing the pilings and making that a better area shoreline-wise. And I would hope that we are able to do some of that work. And the other thing that caught my eye was something that I've talked to you about on other occasions, and that is signage. For the first time, there is added into this document a requirement for the control of signage in this area. You know, we have a lot of signs around town. I noticed when some people go out of business and the place sits there for a year or 2 years or 3 years or even more, the signs seem to still remain. We used to require that they be removed or covered up. So I was glad to see that at least in this document, there was an addressing of the signage question around the wastewater treatment plant. Thank you.
Anybody else like to speak this evening? City staff, would you like to wish to is this our last
night? No.
I need a break. Okay.
For you.
Do you wish upon a star to offer clarifying information in response to the citizen testimony provided?
No, it's not needed.
Thank you. Does any member of the council have a question to clarify information provided by the public or staff? Well, we're good. Any speakers from the audience have a question to clarify information? Then at this time, since all citizens wishing to speak have had an opportunity to do so, and since participants have had the opportunity to ask questions regarding testimony provided, it's appropriate to close the public hearing. Thank you all for being here and participating in this public hearing. I'll turn it over to council to take action. Councilmember Cotton, thank you.
Ordinance number, please.
3318.
I move the ordinance number 3318, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopting a periodic update to the Lynnwood Shoreline Master Program to reflect updates to state law and the Washington Administrative Code, amending LMC 17.20.005, authorizing the mayor to transmit the Shoreline Master Program to be reviewed and approved by the Washington State Department of Ecology, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
Would you like to speak to that, Councilmember Cotton?
Yeah, this is important for us. You know, though it is only 700 linear feet of shoreline, it is important, in, as we're all aware, in the Puget Sound, how closely we guard and cherish our waterways, and so it is important that we do this. It puts us ahead of schedule with state compliance, which I commend staff for being so diligent in getting that done. And I think this is a great way for us to continue to manage the resources that we do have in our stewardship.
You have any other comments? No? Roll call. Vote, please.
Okay. Council President Cotton?
Well, all right.
Oh, my God.
Get a promotion there.
Hey.
Congratulations.
Yeah.
My
that's
God.
Checked off.
Okay. Well, I need one too. I need
you need a break too?
Councilmember Cotton.
Yes.
Councilmember Frizzell.
Yes.
Council President Goodwin.
Yes.
Council Vice President Sessions.
Yes.
Councilmember Ross.
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton.
Yes.
Councilmember Hurst.
Aye.
Seven yes.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3318 passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, staff. So moving on to 90.3A, what I was going to ask is that we go into an executive session for 10 minutes to only talk about personnel, the Teamster Labor, right? Teamster Labor's not ready. Okay. And then come back and finish up our ordinances. But I am sensitive that there were at least two people here that were interested in the neighborhood parking permit, and I'm wondering whether we want to do that first in consideration of your time this evening. Is that okay, Council? All right, so let's move to 90.3C. This is the ordinance on neighborhood permit parking program.
I'm electronically trying to find this. Mm-hmm. Well,
then you want to take it, Council, first?
Sure.
All right.
Ordinance number, please, which I think is 3319.
Yes, thank you.
Good. So because I still can't find it. I got maps galore here.
Okay.
Yes, it is. I move that an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, establishing a parking management and street parking permit program within public residential street parking areas, adding a new chapter 11.48 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second.
And would you like to speak to that, Councilmember Hurst?
I would be delighted. As we've heard, two speakers have come forth, and this, for their specific neighborhood, this has been going on for a couple of years, and it's really frustrating. And so I'm really glad that staff has brought this forward. And the only thing I would do, would like to make a motion, though, on that. And I move to make the following changes to the proposed ordinance. Section 11.48.040, paragraph D, lost or stolen permits. On line 24, delete the sentence starting, "the city will not replace." Instead, the sentence shall read, "a lost or stolen permit will be replaced upon payment of a fee to be established in LMC 3.104.120.
Second.
I'm not done.
Let's do them one at a time.
You want to do it at one time?
Yeah,
okay.
That's easier.
It just bothered me that if a permit was lost, that it was there, they wouldn't be replaced till the end of the year, and I thought that was unreasonable. Okay, then I'm going to make a...
Anybody, any other discussion on the amendment?
Just...
Vice President?
Thank you, Councilmember Hurst, for doing that.
Could you repeat your motion? I got a little...
Yes.
...up on it.
Okay.
Let's get people to the right page. 90.3C6.
Is that where it is?
Mm-hmm. Page 4 of the document.
I'm almost
of the
there.
Ordinance.
I'm almost there.
Mm-hmm. And moving to line 24, the last part of that sentence.
We're getting there. There we go. How about to clarify? I could read this section, the whole section, which is lost or stolen permits. The way it reads is, protection of resident or guest parking permits are the sole responsibility of the resident to which each permit is registered. The city will not replace a permit registered to a vehicle until after the expiration date of the lost or stolen permit. So what my motion is, would read that in that section, on line 24, that I would delete the sentence that says the city will not replace, and replace that whole sentence with another one that says a lost or stolen permit will be replaced upon payment of a fee to be established in LMC 3.104.120, because we don't have that fee yet, and we will, I'm sure, establish it before we have some neighborhood parking. But I just didn't want people to have to wait perhaps a year.
Mm-hmm. Any other comments or questions? All right, all those in favor of approving the amendment that Councilmember Hurst put forward with regard to lost permits, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? All right, so moved. So now you have a second one.
I do. So I would move that in section 11.48.060, paragraph A, which involves enforcement, it's page 5 of the draft ordinance, line 2 on page 5 of the draft ordinance, delete the section of the sentence that follows impound in accordance with city code and state law, and replace that with impound within 48 hours of initial ticket of infraction.
Second.
And the reason I bring this forward is that I think part of the frustration that both Mr. Colvin and Andrich has seen is that the city could take up to 7 days to respond. And I think the whole point of part of this ordinance is that not to have cars still sitting there after 7 days of being ticketed. It's going to be a signed area that says permit parking only, and I think it'd be unreasonable to, for a resident to have to call and then wait 7 days for someone to be towed away from in front of their mailbox, which is what's happening right now.
Okay. Council President?
Thank you, Your Honor. So the concerns I have with changing that, do you happen to know, Councilmember Hurst, I'm asking you, because you brought forward, do you know what city code says or state law says about removing or impounding vehicles? I don't know offhand, that's what
I all I know, did we lose the police chief?
No, he's there.
Okay. That they have up to 7 days, as I understand it, on through LMC before a car has to be impounded. Is that, can we ask the chief?
Yeah, chief, if you'd like to come forward.
Or the attorney. The concern I have is if we say within 48 hours, but that violates either the LMC, which we could change if needs be, or state law, then that onus would be on us to either pay for the fees and possibly other issues that may arise by towing someone's car.
And the only thing I have from experience is, right along with one of our officers, there was a poor Edmonds Community College student parked in the no parking zone, and that car was impounded that day. I mean, within an hour, the tow truck was there. So I think that's feasible. What do you say, Chief?
Chief? Do you want to speak before Chief?
Okay. Chief? I can't speak directly to the LMC at this point without having a chance to research it. What I will say is that the obligation to impound within a specific amount of time does put the onus on the department, and based upon staff, based upon call load a particular day, based upon whatever circumstances are going on, that could be difficult for us. Our intention absolutely is to be as responsive as possible once this is implemented, and we certainly celebrate it as well. And as was mentioned by the testimony earlier at Citizen Comments, our officers do respond when we can. I think that keeping it within the framework of an ordinance and state law within the framework of that is appropriate. Also, if state law were to change or there were some sort of additional requirement that were to be implemented later, we would have to come back and amend this if we had the 48 hours. So I'm by no means saying we want to take as much time as possible to do it. We are very sensitive to the issues that have been created in those particular areas. I just feel like complying with state law or within the LMC is a fairly general statement that we can comply with. But I'm with you in spirit, absolutely, to help the community.
Vice President Sessions?
Oh, thank you. I was just curious as well about what the LMC said directly. And if I recall, it's different, too. Like, for example, maybe the officer you're talking about, maybe it was in a fire lane. That's different than other areas. I don't know what the situation was. But it's different rules. And so I wouldn't be comfortable voting on this without knowing what that is, because we wouldn't want to put together something in here that we'd have to change anyway. And again, the spirit of it is very good, and I appreciate the work to try to clean it up. But we can always do faster and better. But if we can't enforce it, I don't like to change it if we can't for sure enforce that.
Council President.
Thank you. To finish the thought that I had with regard to that, after hearing what Police Chief Davis said, I think the thing that strikes me is having it follow city code and state law will allow us, as the chief said, as that law changes, the ordinance will be current because it'll follow the state law and the city code. And I think, as was just brought up, if there are issues where it's vehicles blocking an emergency lane, where as was mentioned, there was a vehicle that the plates didn't match the car, things like that, I think those are things where the police have more discretion and they can do that much more quickly. So I would vote to keep it the way it is, so that we're following state code and law, and it's update, as that's updated, we're staying updated with it.
Okay. Any other comments, concerns? All right. All those in favor of amending ordinance number
319
to rewrite the line number 2 that currently says in accordance with city code and state law, and change it to within 48 hours of initial ticket of infraction. All those in favor of that change, please say aye.
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 Oh boy. How many was that?
Three.
All those opposed, please say no.
Nay.
And was that 4? Such a good course. All right, so that one fails. So we are back to the first motion for the ordinance. Is there any more discussion on the ordinance? Yeah, Council President?
Yeah, I just want to give my thanks to staff for the preparation of the ordinance with the work that they did. I know they worked on it for quite a long time, and they did a lot of research beyond just our jurisdiction. And so I appreciate the work that they did trying to bring in something that will hopefully solve and resolve the issues that some of the neighbors here have come and expressed, but also for the future as Sound Transit comes in and, parking becomes even more scarce on certain roads. It'll allow us to take a look at that and use the same ordinance for resolving those issues as well. So thank you for your work, staff. I appreciate that.
All right. Yes, Councilmember Frizzell.
And I just wanted to thank not only the two gentlemen that came tonight, but the folks that came before you and before them that have brought this to our attention and have kind of kept on us to make sure that we get something resolved. And I really look forward to some relief for you and a few other neighborhoods. So thank you for being part of the process.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I too would like to, I appreciate the staff getting us together. It was a long process. And, I think obviously there's procedures that have to be followed even for these neighborhood permits to happen. And in the meantime, we'll do some research on the LMC and state law. Thank you.
Any other comments? All right, roll call, please.
I have it now.
You have it now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Council Vice President Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton.
Affirmative.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3319 passes with the one amendment in section 11.48.040, paragraph D. All right, Council, do you need a break? I will offer you a couple-minute break as we move to the executive session room if you need it. Otherwise, we'll go straight there. What, do you want a break?
A little
one. Okay. So 8:10, please make sure that you're in the conference room down the hall, and we are going into an executive session with the topic of personnel, and we will be 10 minutes. That means we should be back out of here at 20 after. All right? All right. Great. Thank you. All right, council and audience, we are at 90.3B. We just had our executive session, and this is a confirmation of our human resources director. And I think council president is going to make a motion.
Indeed, I will. Your Honor, I move that we, the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, confirm the appointment of Mr. Evan Chin as the Human Resources Director for the City of Lynnwood.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion?
This has been a process that has been in place for a few months. We had two fantastic candidates, and in our discussions, and I think the mayor with her administration and her staff came to the conclusion that Mr. Chin would fit best and very well for the City of Lynnwood, and so we are excited to have him join us and forward to working with him and rebuilding our human resources department. So,
anything else? Yes, Council Vice President?
Just welcome. We're very happy to have you and looking forward to getting to know you better. And thank you for your servant's heart in helping our HR department as well, just to over through this transition. And I'm sure they're all excited to have you as well. Thanks.
Anybody else? All those in favor of appointing Evan Chin to the HR director position, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? All right, welcome.
Welcome.
Come on forward. We got to do a photo.
Say a few words.
Oh, you want to say a few words? Oh, yes. Let us sit down.
Well, I'd like to thank the mayor for the appointment and for the rousing confirmation from the council. I am looking forward to working with the HR staff and, as the president said, looking at rebuilding the team. I would like to thank Lori for her leadership in the interim and all the hard work that she's put in. I am looking forward to what the future brings to the City of Lynnwood and for the employees so that they can best serve the residents and citizens here as we go through a time of tremendous growth and change and a changing demographic of the city that would be able to embrace and engage in an equitable way with the people that work here and the residents who will derive from our services. So, again, thank you very much. Oh, yes, and in the audience is my wife, Katie, and she'll be on this journey with me.
All right, Council. Oh, welcome. I'm so excited. Okay. 90.3D, this is the ordinance for our 2018 budget amendments, and Vice President Sessions would like to lead us off.
Sure. 3220? Oh, thank you. 3320? All right. I move ordinance number 3320, an ordinance of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, adopting amendments to the 2017-18 biennial budget, providing for transmittal of the amended budget to the state, and providing for severability, an effective date, and summary publication.
Second. Would you like to speak to that?
Yes, please. We have reviewed these budget amendments. One of the larger parts of this amendment was a budgetary impact to the general fund from the receipt of a ground emergency medical transport, the GEMT revenues, and the required related transfer of funds to the state health care authority in order to be able to receive these funds. So that's good news. And so that's the big part of this.
All right, any other comments? All right, roll call, please.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Council Vice President Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cott?
Yes.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Affirmative.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3320 passes unanimously. We'll move on to 90.3E. This is our ordinance for the fee schedule amendments, including the small cell antennas. And would a council member like to... Councilmember Hurst, thank you.
Let's see, ordinance number
3321.
Mm-hmm. All right. I move ordinance 3321, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, relating to the fee schedule, amending LMC 3.104.210, LMC 3.104.220, and LMC 3.14. Well, let me read that again. LMC 3.104.230, and providing for an effective date, severability, and summary publication.
Second.
Thank you. And would you like to speak to that, Councilor Hurst?
Sure. This is I have it in front of me. This is a amendment to the fee schedule and involves actually three purposes. There's a section on the small cell antennas, and then there's a section on parks and recreation fees, and then a correction of a technology fee. So it's all included here in this ordinance. I would like to move to postpone the vote on the establishment of the permit and rental fees for small cell antennas until the last business meeting of January 2019. The FCC order allows higher fees based on an analysis of what is reasonable and justified, and there really hasn't been time to perform that analysis, and that's why I would like to postpone that section.
Second. Yes.
Just to clarify, that would remove from Exhibit A the changes shown under the heading of wireless communication facility?
Yes. For now.
Yes, until January.
Yeah.
Any other discussion?
Can I speak?
Can you speak?
To my motion?
Yes, you can speak to
Thank
your
you.
Motion.
And if I can find my notes, I will. So I've been, I did reach out last week or after the last work session because I said I would to certain other cities. Three responded, one in that they haven't done anything. Issaquah says they will never allow, that would be interesting, never allow the small cell deployment on any of their city-owned property. And then I just did get a response from the city of Mercer Island, and it was really informative, and they've come up with a justifiable cost, they feel, of $868 per wireless node. And the FCC order does allow cities, if they can show a reasonable fee and the costs involved, that it could be over that $270, I think that's listed here as far as an annual fee. So there are some things, and there's some concerns that I wish maybe Paul or Todd had stayed, because the order also sets in some shot. They call it shot clocks, where you only have a certain time frame between application and permitting. And my concern is, if it's such a short time with the workload that we have, does that mean we have to hire consultants? That'll be added costs involved in that. And then there are actually some changes as far as in the code that we created. Say, for the city code, it talks about auxiliary equipment for the antennas. We limit it to 17 cubic feet. Well, the FCC code has 28 cubic feet. So I really want planning to kind of take a look at that and see what kind of impact they feel is going on. So I'm not saying we're not going to, we need to implement some fees, but I think just giving us a little more time to look at it would be great. Thank you.
Either conversation, Councilmember Cotton.
Thank you, Your Honor. Thank you, Councilmembers. I'm in support of the motion, just because along the way that we've kind of done this, first we were going to, kind of piggyback on a PUD fee schedule study, and then that didn't seem to be forthcoming or tracking with the timeline we were on. And so it seems like it's now the time for us to really go ahead and say, okay, given some of the things that the FCC is handing to us as mandates, if they can really even truly mandate, which is another question that's out there. From an enforcement mechanism, but to me, it seems like there's value in us studying it, and especially some of the things that Councilmember Hurst has mentioned, and knowing Director Krause has been very transparent with us about the workload of his department and the things going on over there. And so I'm concerned that if we don't set a reasonable fee for what is being imposed on our community by this ruling, the residents of the city will end up essentially paying for large companies to make more money. So it seems to me an equity issue to go ahead and just figure out what the number is for our community and roll that. So
that's all. Councilmember Goodwin.
Thank you, Your Honor. I will support the amendment. One of the concerns, I guess, that I've thought about over this is I hope that we can, as a council, kind of learn from this, because it seemed at first we were pushing, trying to get this thing passed right away. And had we done that, we would not be able to do what we're doing now and kind of take a step back and look at that. So I'm glad to see that we are kind of taking that moment to say, yes, we do need to do more analysis. Maybe not wait for the PUD, because we don't know when that analysis will come, but for the city to be able to do our own analysis and come up with those costs that will work and can be defensible, I think is a good idea for us to help set those policies. Like I think we should do with most any other policies, is make sure that we have all the information that we need, or as much as we can get, to really make those decisions we make very defensible. So in that regard, I will support this, because I think that is the best way to go about finding out what that cost will be for the city. Thank you.
Councilmember Frizzell.
This has been in front of us untold times, it seems like. We've been hashing this out for quite a while. And I think that one of the things that brings up is that it's not as simple as it first looked when it came in front of council. And with the lawsuits going on with Seattle and Renton being involved, I see waiting as not a bad choice at this point. So I would support the amendment here as well.
Councilmember Sutton.
Thank you, Your Honor. I do agree with this.
I think if we are to wrap it and we go ahead and say this is how much we want and then it's revamped, then we would be, I think, worse off than what we are now. So I do agree with that. I also know that there's other cities that charge a lot more. And I think it would be good if we were to maybe have it where we could have an average of the ranges, and then maybe that would help us kind of come up with a satisfactory amount.
All right, any more discussion? All those in favor, this is the amendment. So all those in favor of supporting the motion by Councilmember Hurst to postpone the vote on the establishment of permit and rental fees for small cell antennas until the last business meeting of January 2019, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposition? All right, so moved. So we're back to our original ordinance that's on the table. Oh.
No. Is there opportunity for public comment before the amendment to the bill?
Not at this juncture, but as we go forward.
Yeah. Well, for the vote that you just took, is there public comment on the vote that you just took to remove that item from the ordinance for the union?
Not really.
I didn't bring Robert's Rules of Order with me, so I'm relying on other experts in,
well, I'm
in
looking
the area.
At our attorney.
Well, not under your ordinary agenda. The public comment period has already passed. Mm-hmm. The council could allow it, but it's not on your agenda.
All right. You've already voted. Does council want to hear a comment?
What's the nature of the comment?
Sure. If I may.
Wait.
For me, the concern that I have is we've had a number of work sessions where we discuss this item. What I don't want to do is set a precedent to accept comment at any point during the meeting because we specifically have our rules set so that we can receive public comment, and we're open to doing that. But if we do that at each item or when someone feels necessary to talk in the middle of one of those items, that will likely prevent us from doing the work that we're here to do on a meeting-per-meeting basis.
Very good. Thank you.
So might I suggest that you send an email to Beth Morris and share your comments, and all of council will get that?
Very good. We're working with staff now, so we will be in loop with staff, so that's very good.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here tonight. Yeah. All right, so for Ordinance 3321, are we ready for roll call or any other comments?
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Council Vice President Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
7 yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3321 passes unanimously without the small cell fee. Included at this point. So we are moving on to 90.3G. This is another ordinance, 2019 City of Lynnwood Salary Schedule. Councilmember would like to put the motion on the floor. Who's that? Oh, Councilmember Cotton, thank you.
I move Ordinance 3322, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, relating to classification of city employee positions, amending Exhibit A to the ordinance number 3314, and providing for severability and effective date and summary publication.
Second. And would you like to speak to that?
Yes, absolutely. This is kind of a process element in regard to some of our negotiating and bargaining units and our budget process, in that our budget contains fee schedules that then get updated throughout the bargaining process. And as that processes are all closing up, this is some of the housekeeping to true up budget and negotiations.
Any other discussion? I will take the roll call, please.
Okay. Council Vice President Sessions?
Yes.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Yes.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Affirmative.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Seven yes, Mayor.
Thank you. Ordinance number 3322 passes unanimously. We'll move on to 90.3H. This is an ordinance amendment, state mandated business licenses. Councilmember Frizzell, thank you.
I would like to propose ordinance 3323, an ordinance of the city of Lynnwood, Washington, related to the licensing and regulation of businesses, adding a new section 5.04.050 to the Lynnwood Municipal Code, amending sections 5.06.010 and 5.06.020 of the Lynnwood Municipal Code, and providing for severability, an effective date, and summary publication.
Second.
Thank you. Would you like to speak to that?
I would. So the state of Washington has implemented a new system with Department of Revenue in which all cities have to go through the state business licensing system in order to register to do business. And there is a $2,000 threshold. So if a business is small and they come into the city of Lynnwood and they're not they don't have office space here, but they do less than $2,000 worth of business, we're not requiring them to have a business license. So it takes care of small businesses and puts us in compliance with Department of Revenue. So that's a good thing.
Thank you. Any other conversation, discussion? Oh, we'll take the roll call, please. Mm-hmm.
Councilmember Sutton?
Yes.
Councilmember Cotton?
Affirmative.
Councilmember Frizzell?
Yes.
Council President Goodwin?
Aye.
Councilmember Hurst?
Aye.
Councilmember Ross?
Yes.
Council Vice President Sessions?
Yes.
Seven yes, Mayor.
Thank you. All right. That was a lot tonight. It's end of year. Mm-hmm. All right, moving on to 100. We have one new business item that needs your attention this evening before the close of the year. And Director Sonia Springer will come forward and explain what this is to you, and then we'll need to take a vote.
So as you may recall, the city issued utility revenue bonds this year, about $20 million. Some of those funds have been invested in shorter-term securities, like 1 year, 2 years. But we have the opportunity to invest in the state treasurer's local government investment pool. So when we contacted the state treasurer's office and say, hey, we want to open a new account for these 2018 bond issue funds, which we have to track separately from the rest of the funds, they said, oh, well, we need Lorenzo Hines to approve a new account. So he was specifically designated as the person that could open up a new account for the city of Lynnwood. Said, that's just not going to happen. So they said, well, we require a resolution to appoint a position, a title, the finance director, to be responsible for adding or changing any kind of accounts at the LGIP. So that's what this resolution does. It's a formatted, tailored to the state treasurer's office format. It requires that one person, one position title, be allowed to create new LGIP accounts. So we can invest the funds in shorter term. If we don't need the funds right away, which we don't, we'll be able to earn more interest than we do at our U.S. bank account.
And how much is this worth to us in December by doing this now?
At 2.5%, about $21,000 a month.
Yeah. Which is what we'd be due this month.
Yeah.
Yeah. Great. All right. Mm-hmm. Any questions for Director Springer? Yeah. Okay. Council Vice President.
Resolution number, please.
2018-11.
All right, I move resolution number 2018-11, a resolution of the City of Lynnwood, Washington, authorizing investment of City of Lynnwood monies in the local government investment pool.
Second.
And would you like to speak to that?
I think our director spoke to that, and I agree. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All right, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposition? Thank you. Thank you, Director Springer, for bringing this to our attention in a timely fashion. All right.
Did we want to do disability?
Sorry?
Did we want to talk about disability or? What do you think?
Rosemary, our city attorney. So the Disabilities Board, Councilmember Cotton resigned his position. It's a two-year appointment. As we understand it, it's the council president that appoints that position. As the Disability Board understands it, the mayor appoints the position. So, Council Vice President Session is ready to be appointed. Do you know if I need to do it or Council President needs to do it?
I don't know without looking at the city code or the RCWs on it. If it is something that needs to be done tonight, perhaps you could both
That's what I figured.
An appointment. Yeah. And then one would be valid.
Awesome.
I mean, so you do the
suspenders. I like it.
Yeah. Okay. That's what I'd like to do if we could do both of them. Yeah. So do you want to start?
Oh, no.
No, you want me to start?
Oh, yes.
I move to appoint Council Vice President Session to the to finish out this year term and then continue into next year since a two-year term. To our disability board, because of Councilmember Cotton resigning. Does that make sense?
No, I moved.
No.
Does it need a second, or are you just
no?
Make
mean,
the appointment?
No, don't you appoint.
If it's the mayor, I mean, if it's an individual who's doing the appointment, you don't actually need the whole council to do a motion.
Right.
No. So appointed by the mayor.
Thank you,
mm-hmm. Council President.
I appoint Cannon to the disability board. Taking the place of Ian Cotton, who resigned, for the remainder of this year and through next year.
You're good.
All right. So done. Congratulations.
Thank you.
When
thank
we're
you
meeting
to both
for you.
Of you.
All right. All right. Any other new business?
Thank you for filling the role, Shannon.
All right. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you. And all those in favor, I'm thinking.
Yes.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you.